Good morning and welcome to our morning worship on this, the festival of Christ the King. You join me here from the Church of St. Stephen's in Winsham. And particularly, I'm leading this service from here today because the Reredos here behind the high altar depicts at the very centre Christ the King. This Reredos was completed in the late 19th century by the acclaimed sculptor Harry Hems, who was based in Exeter. And at the centre we have this carving of Christ the King. Here he is sat on the throne of heaven, where we're told in the scriptures he sits at the right hand of the Father. Surrounding him is this wonderful gold mosaic, representing the kingdom of heaven. He's dressed in robes. If this was a piece of iconography or a piece of art, it's very likely those robes would be coloured red, representing the sacrifice that Jesus makes for us. In his left hand, he holds an orb, a classic symbol of the realms of the kingdom over which somebody has authority. And in this case, it of course represents all things. Creator of all, King of all, King of the universe. Indeed, on that orb there is a two-banded crown, which is a classic piece of symbolism from the Eastern Church to represent just that, Christ the King. His right hand is extended in a typical symbol of blessing, with his two first and second fingers and thumb also extended in that three-way blessing, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, pointing to the triune nature of God. And surrounding him on his throne is this wonderful oval shape opening, another classic symbol representing how we enter into the kingdom of heaven. And in doing so, into that wonderful brightness represented by that gold mosaic, we come to our King, Christ the King, King of all. And if that wasn't enough, at the base, just by his feet, we have the letters A and O in Greek lettering, Alpha and Omega, beginning and end, the universe in its entirety, nothing left out. Christ the King of the kingdom of heaven. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We sing now our first hymn. So as we come before Christ the King, we bring to him those things for which we are sorry. Those things that hurt us and where we have hurt others. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. The kingdom is yours, but we turn away from your just rule. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The power is yours, but we trust in our own power and strength. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. The glory is yours, but we fall short of the glory of God. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We sing now our Gloria. Collect for today. Let us pray. Eternal Father, whose Son Jesus Christ ascended to the throne of heaven that he might rule over all things as Lord and King, keep the Church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at his feet, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to listen now to our readings, followed by our talk from Reverend Judith.
I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love towards all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that, with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance amongst the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand, and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they will also answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life.
Just before Advent begins, leading to the birth of Jesus at Christmas, we are invited to lift our thoughts to the heavens and to the glory and majesty of Christ the Son of God. We use the term Christ the King. In trying to describe the wonder and the glory of Christ the King, language and definitions must fail because the full reality of God is unknowable. But nevertheless, we are invited to extend our horizons along with Paul as he writes of the way that Christ has been raised and exalted to the highest place in the spiritual structure of the universe. Having raised Christ from the dead, the Father has seated him at his right hand, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but in the age to come. Thus, Paul offers us some insight into the mystical workings of the heavenly realms. And humanly limited though our understanding is, we can only turn to praise and worship our King of Kings and Lord of Lords, whose chief characteristic is love, in its breadth, length, height and depth, surpassing knowledge and filling us with the fullness of God. The kingdom of heaven on earth seems much less glorious. Vitally, as Jesus walked the earth, Christ's kingship was not acted out in earthly glory, but in humble and sometimes agonizing servanthood. Jesus, Son of God, was, most astonishingly and frustratingly to some of his contemporaries, not so interested in the great or the good as he was in seeking the lost and sharing not just the joys, but the poverty and degradation of human experience, always compelled by love. Turning to the gospel for today, we find Christ in another role, as judge, famously and forbiddingly perhaps, dividing the sheep from the goats. Christ's judgment might be seen as the final examination to discover what we have learnt from the lessons he has taught us himself. It should not come as a surprise that the yardstick of judgment is the one that Jesus, incarnate Son of God, used throughout his earthly ministry. He said, "I came not to be served, but to serve, to give my life as a ransom, to show you the way, to demonstrate what the love of God means in practice." And it is the practice that counts, because just believing isn't enough. Faith needs to be demonstrated practically in real life situations. It is very clear that in Christ's kingdom, the hungry, thirsty, impoverished are to be cared for, not just because we have a common humanity, but because Christ the King is to be found and served in each person. Does this passage mean that anybody who does good deeds to help the needy is in the sheep division, deserving of eternal life, regardless of whether they have any personal faith in Jesus Christ? It is a good question. So as ever, when reading the Bible, we need to keep it in the context of all else that is written for our instruction. And it is clear that there is something fundamentally important about responding in person to the call of Christ to repent and believe and commit to following his way, living by his grace rather than by our own efforts. Yet, here it is. Whenever you reach out a hand in compassion to help others, as Jesus did in his years of earthly ministry, you are reaching out to Christ. Jesus Christ incorporates all such actions within the mysteries of the heavenly realms, and they become part of the height, length, breadth, depth of his divine love. The small and unglamorous acts of love and service we can offer here on earth raise us from earth to heaven as we participate in the coming of the kingdom where Christ is King. The sublime descriptions of Christ exalted inspire us in our daily walk with Jesus, who is close to us as friend and saviour. Amen.
we say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come and come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us with confidence present our prayers and supplications to the throne of grace. We pray for all those in positions of power, that they may govern with wisdom and integrity, serving the needs of their people. May your reign come. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the Church, the sign of your reign, that it may extend your welcome to people of every race and background. May your kingdom come. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for Christians of every denomination, that together we may come to understand the royal priesthood you bestowed on us in baptism. May your dominion come. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those whose commitment to truth brings them into conflict with earthly powers, that they may have the courage to endure. May your rule come. Lord, hear our prayer. Loving God, you have taught us that the power of the heart is greater than the power of wealth and might. Hear us as we pray for the fulfilment of your reign. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our King. To him be glory and power forever. Amen. Now we pray together the prayer our Saviour, Jesus Christ the King, taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We're now going to sing our next hymn.
Lord, as we find time.
Psalm 45, verse 6. Your throne is God's throne forever. The sceptre of your kingdom is the sceptre of righteousness. It's been a pleasure to worship Christ the King with you today, wherever this finds you. Do look out for things that we'll be doing during Advent and in the run-in to Christmas on this very different year. Look out for notices that come out in the weekly circular, but also online, and various things that will be happening or things that you can engage with. And so the blessing. God the Father, who has given to his Son the name above every name, strengthen you to proclaim Christ Jesus as Lord. God the Son, who is our great High Priest, passed into the heavens, plead for you at the right hand of the Father. God the Holy Spirit, who pours out his abundant gifts upon the Church, make you faithful servants of Christ our King. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you all, this day and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.